Indonesia has the second highest level of biodiversity in the world. Its 17,000 islands are home to various plants and animals, which can only be found in their natural habitat in the archipelago and nowhere else. But these species face a challenge for survival. Besides deforestation and climate change, wildlife trafficking is also a major threat to their existence. I take you to North Sulawesi, where the trade in wildlife is thriving, even during the COVID-19 pandemic. I'll also find out how authorities are working to protect endangered animals and the challenges they face. I would like to warn our viewers that they may find some of the footage in this episode disturbing.
Buaya ini dipelihara dari kecil oleh masyarakat itu ya, karena sudah besar mereka sudah takut, makanya ditelepon oleh kami untuk evakuasi ke PKSDA.
Keeping wild animals as pets is a common trend here in North Sulawesi, a province a little over 3 hours by air from Jakarta. I'm here at Manado Town, where part of the community views consumption of exotic meat or keeping of exotic animals as a form of status symbol.
Once an animal has been evacuated, it is brought here to the North Sulawesi Agency for Conservation of Natural Resources. Animals are then housed temporarily in these transit cages, after which they are taken to be rehabilitated and released.
Located at the Bay of Manado and surrounded by mountains, North Sulawesi is part of Sulawesi Island, the largest island in Wallace, with a high level of endemism. This means that animals typical of Sulawesi cannot be found anywhere else other than in their natural habitat. Many native species have unique features and appearances, making them easy targets for poachers. The North Sulawesi Agency for Conservation of Natural Resources runs its operations in 13 territories, including in neighboring Gorontalo province. While the agency serves to protect all animals, some are at higher risk of potential extinction, and these are classified as priority animals. It's no easy feat. North Sulawesi, with its proximity to the Philippines and community habits of keeping exotic pets, is a hotspot for animal trafficking.
Fokusnya itu untuk mencegah ada satwa liar yang dibawa dari luar provinsi Sulawesi Utara. Jadi lokasi-lokasi yang sering kita patroli atau kita sering tunggu di situ kendaraan itu di desa Inobonto dan desa Lolak.
Kenapa di situ, Pak? Apakah itu perbatasan atau gimana?
Ya, kalau untuk Lolak itu sudah dekat dengan perbatasan. Kemudian kalau untuk Inobonto itu di percabangan jalan interchange.
But a lack of manpower makes enforcement an uphill task for the agency. Active personnel on the ground are extremely limited, with only small teams from the agency deployed to patrol entry points. In the case of monitoring illicit activities at the airport and seaports, only one officer is put in charge from the agency. The agency relies heavily on working together with other institutions and NGOs in order to effectively carry out its duties. The provinces Manado and Bitung ports are major trading hubs from Indonesia to the rest of Asia. North Sulawesi, through Bitung Harbor, is the exit and entry point for wildlife such as reptiles and hornbills from the Philippines to Indonesia, with the transit point in Sangihe Islands.
Ships like this travel to the surrounding islands, and it is on these ships that wildlife is usually transported illegally. According to officials, wildlife trade through these ports are usually dominated by birds.
Wildlife trade from North Sulawesi to the Philippines is generally dominated by the smuggling of various cockatoo and lory species. Not even the raging COVID-19 pandemic can stop the trafficking. Rather, movement restrictions have pushed smugglers to find new ways of transporting animals.
Masih ada sih, tapi jarang nemu, karena mereka bawanya itu tidak susah untuk diidentifikasi langsung. Mereka cara bawanya itu tidak dibawa di dalam bentuk dos atau kandang. Jadi mereka ngisinya di botol. Jadi susah untuk deteksi apakah yang orang ini bawa burung atau enggak. Tapi selama pandemi sih karena pembatasan juga orang berangkat ini kan jarang, jadi agak jarang juga sih kami.
The COVID-19 pandemic, however, has slowed wildlife rescue efforts in the province. My next stop, the Tasikoki Wildlife Rescue and Education Center. Located about an hour from Manado town by road, is a key arm of the province's wildlife rescue efforts. Spanning 55 hectares, 15 hectares is used by the center to house and rehabilitate animals that have been rescued from dire situations. At the start of the pandemic in Indonesia, the center saw rescue and release efforts impeded because of various community restrictions. They also faced some difficulty in accessing several rescue areas. But the situation has since improved in light of the lifting of pandemic measures in the country. As of mid-December last year, the center housed nearly 400 animals, 331 of which consisted of 37 types of protected animals. One such protected animal is the Sulawesi black-crested macaque, known as the yaki. This particular yaki, named Cantik, was rescued after being kept as a pet for about 3 years. Besides the yaki, the anoa is also at the brink of extinction. The anoa is the world's smallest species of wild cattle and is found only on the island of Sulawesi. It is listed as an endangered species by the International Union for the Conservation of Nature. And my final stop is the Tangkoko Batuangus Nature Reserve in Bitung District, one of the oldest conservation forests in the country. One of four conservation areas spanning over 85 kilometers of forest and mountains, the reserve area is inhabited by hundreds of mammals, birds, and reptiles, a majority of which are endemic to the island. COVID-19 has taken away the swarms of foreign tourists that were a staple at the reserve, slashing at least $70,000 a year of gate receipts that are used to operate the nature reserve and support the livelihoods of forestry personnel.
Mau dari penjaga hutan, mau dari pemandu, itu memang semua ekonomi rusak. Berdampak sekali ke ekonomi. Karena COVID ini sudah mau 2 tahun, pengunjung tidak pernah ada yang ke sini.
Today, authorities are cracking down a lot harder on animal trafficking. The current Conservation Act, in place since 1990, carries a maximum penalty sentence of 5 years and a maximum fine of about $7,000 for wildlife smugglers. The Indonesian government enacted a tougher quarantine act in 2019, which stipulates that wild animals and plants entering and leaving the country must be reported to the quarantine agency with supporting documents. This act sets higher sentences with a maximum jail term of 10 years and a fine of up to $700,000 in the hopes of deterring illegal animal trade effectively. However, activists say these measures are simply not enough, citing the low rate of prosecution. Punishment for illegal wildlife trade is low compared to how much traders could profit off sales. While the 2019 Quarantine Act is a right step forward, law experts say it has loopholes and needs ironing out. Activists say one of the main obstacles to eradicating the illegal animal trade in Indonesia has been ineffective law enforcement, and much work needs to be done. But the province's biggest challenge yet, according to authorities, is the locals' insatiable appetite for bushmeat. Next up, I'll bring you straight to the notorious Tomohon Bushmeat Market. At an altitude of over 700 meters above sea level, the hilly city of Tomohon has many natural tourist spots. Despite this, the town is notorious worldwide for one thing.
I'm about to enter Sulawesi's largest bushmeat market. Spanning 1.5 hectares, it is located in the center of the city of Tomohon in North Sulawesi.
It's 7 a.m. and the market is already bustling. Whisking visitors into its sights, the sounds and smells can be overpowering for people who aren't used to the regular fare. One of 7 markets in the country, the Beriman Wilkin Market, as it is known officially, is not for the faint-hearted. Dogs, cats, wild boar, whole pigs, bats, snakes 3 meters long, and more are slaughtered, torched, divided into parts, and sold here as staples. I meet with Ira Fitria Alitakawuwong, who is making her weekly grocery run. Born and raised in Tomohon, the 25-year-old is Mina Hassan, an ethnic group native to the largely Christian province of North Sulawesi, with a population of some 2.66 million. Historically, the Mina Hassan people were known to hunt, and as such, would consume what they hunted. Unlike the majority of Indonesia's Muslim population, bushmeat has been a part of their consumption pattern for generations, and it continues to be a part of their daily lives. Bushmeat is significantly cheaper than other staples like chicken or beef, which is another factor as to why locals prefer it. Today, Ira is buying fruit bats. Locally known as paniki, it's on the pricey side and costs her almost 10 US dollars for two. But it is still relatively cheaper than a kilogram of beef or a whole chicken, which both start at 7 US dollars.
Banyak selain ikan paniki,
yeah.
Suka makan ikan apa aja lagi?
Babi hutan, iya. Yeah. Ada juga anjing tapi nggak makan, orang rumah yang makan. Ular enggak. Ada juga yang apa, beris, itu kayak burung, tapi boleh makan, itu enak. Dagingnya manis.
Kalau tikus?
Tikus manis juga, enak, dia makan.
Bushmeat is widely available for sale in most of the markets and supermarkets in North Sulawesi, a province which is dominated by the ethnic Minahasan, with an estimated around 800,000 residents. According to a recent research report, it is estimated that over 300 tons of bats and 70 tons of snakes were sold in the province every year between 2018 and 2019. As a result of overwhelming demand, the wildlife population within the province has dwindled dramatically due to overhunting. Local officials say some 90% of the meat sold in North Sulawesi province now comes from other parts of the Sulawesi island, from cities like Kendari, Gorontalo, and Makassar, among others. All the animals now sold here are not of protected status, but this wasn't always the case. As recently as 2016, people were still buying and consuming the yaki, although it was getting harder for suppliers to source for the primate. David Karore, who has been a bushmeat trader for the last 12 years, says increased awareness on the protected and vulnerable status of wild animals has been key in deterring traders, including him, from selling them.
Pas dijual, apakah populer? Banyak orang mau?
Oh, banyak sekali. Yang apa?
Babi putih,
babi rusa. Dia lebih enak daripada babi hutan.
Harganya bisa berapa, Pak, kisaran? Berapa satu kilo berapa?
35 sampai 40 per kilo.
Dan kalau untuk yaki?
Yaki ada mahal-mahal ya, 50 kan, 50 ribu. Mirip-mirip ular.
At a maximum estimated weight of 15 kilograms, one yaki could set locals back by a little over 50 US dollars. That hefty price tag is pushing the species ever closer to extinction.
Endemic to North Sulawesi, the Sulawesi crested black macaque, known as the yaki, has distinctive features. It has what looks like a mohawk on its head and a pinkish, heart-shaped bottom. Its population has steadily declined over the last 20 years, and it continues to decline to this day.
In May 2021, bushmeat traders, along with the Tomohon city government, the North Sulawesi police, and animal activists, signed a joint declaration committing not to sell protected wildlife. Founded in 2011, Animal Friends Manado Indonesia, or AFMI, have long worked to not only stop the trade and consumption of bushmeat, but also that of domestic animals such as dogs and cats. AFMI has rescued hundreds of dogs since it was first founded, and the organization has been working closely with Tomohon City authorities since 2017.
Indonesia sudah memiliki begitu banyak aturan yang mengatur tentang perlindungan, baik satwa liar yang dilindungi maupun yang tidak dilindungi. Ada batasan kuota untuk menjaga keseimbangan ekosistem. Tapi realita yang terjadi di lapangan yaitu karena lemahnya penegakan hukum, lemahnya pengawasan, sampai perdagangan ini boleh dikatakan tanpa kontrol. Itu baru dari segi perdagangan, belum dari segi kesehatan sumber pangan itu.
old habits have made it challenging to put a stop to the consumption of wildlife in North Sulawesi. Those working to protect it say.
Masih banyak yang belum paham dan sadar dari sisi sebenarnya kenapa ada orang yang masih memakan itu, karena di beberapa daerah itu masih dianggap hidangan spesial. Tuan rumah kadang ingin menyajikan sesuatu yang spesial supaya ada orang yang datang jauh-jauh mendapat hidangan yang spesial. Dan juga ada yang masih beranggapan bahwa itu mempunyai khasiat tertentu ya, untuk meningkatkan stamina atau sebagai obat.
The threat of contracting COVID-19 has not deterred people from consuming bushmeat in North Sulawesi either. While the market had limited opening hours during the pandemic, when sales dropped by over 60%, purchases never completely stopped in North Sulawesi. Experts say there is a deep concern of zoonosis in the community, which is why it's important to stop wildlife consumption.
Mungkin ada penyakit yang belum muncul, belum diteliti, tetapi si hewan liar tersebut sudah memilikinya, maksudnya sudah ada di dalam tubuhnya. Dan mungkin bagi hewan itu tidak jadi masalah bakteri atau virus tersebut, tetapi setelah dikonsumsi manusia malah jadi masalah, malah menjadi penyakit yang memang membahayakan.
So far, the COVID-19 pandemic has little impact on the lifestyle of the Minahasan people. Altering deeply entrenched mindsets and habits that are cultivated over generations is not an easy thing to do. Today, campaigns and educational talks are conducted in schools like this one, aiming to spread awareness and educate the importance of conservation and health risks of consuming domestic animals as well as wildlife. North Sulawesi's best chance to stop wildlife consumption might just lie with the youth, who may be willing to change the norm for future generations. Coming up next, we explore the obsession of Indonesians over bird keeping and how the trading goes online. The sound of birds chirping is believed to promote peace of mind. Keeping caged songbirds is also a centuries-old tradition among Javanese as a form of status symbol, and that obsession has now spread across the country. According to a 2020 paper published in the International Journal of Biological Conservation, in Java alone, one-third of its 36 million households keep up to 84 million caged birds, and majority of those bird species are endemic to Wallasi, where Sulawesi is the largest island. Here in North Sulawesi, the bird trade is one of the biggest threats to their existence, aside from deforestation and climate change. The bird trade was mostly conducted offline previously, but has spread online in recent years with the rise of social media, officials say, and it is now thriving.
Here in North Sulawesi, birds are the most sought-after animals on the black market online. The rarer they are, the higher the price. Like the palm cockatoo, which can cost up to $3,500.
Marketing animals has gotten a lot easier for perpetrators online. A typical day for officers monitoring online activity would include identifying marketplaces for illegal trading in community bird groups like this one. The seller has put up pictures and videos of several protected birds. Among them are protected species: the ornate lorikeet, white cockatoo, and yellow-crested cockatoo. The yellow-crested cockatoo is listed as critically endangered by the International Union for Conservation of Nature. Sellers never explicitly state the prices for the birds they're offering, so officials have to bait sellers by pretending to be serious buyers in order to meet in person and nab them. While this method has proved successful, the internet has also made it easier for perpetrators to make a hasty escape. And that is the biggest challenge for authorities when it comes to monitoring activity online.
Ketika kita sudah mulai mengumpulkan informasi dan akan kami tindak lanjuti, tiba-tiba yang diutarakan tadi, akunnya hilang dan juga kami tidak bisa melacak. Itu selama ini tantangan terbesar kami seperti itu.
The authorities would normally receive at least 3 tip-offs from the call center hotline per week. Today, officials tell us they've received a credible tip-off from members of the community. And we accompany a two-man field team who have orders to conduct a raid and evacuate a bird being kept illegally. After a 30-minute drive, we arrive at a home in a residential area, with a black-capped lorry kept in a cage outside. The officers approach the homeowners immediately. They explain the reason for their visit and give the homeowners a chance to voluntarily give up the bird. One of the owners, Ms. Sendi, says she knew the bird was of a protected status, but she chose to keep it anyway.
Kalau dilindungi, iya kita tahu memang itu dilindungi. Cuma apa yang bilang? Cuma orang kasih toh itu, jadi cuma suka piara-piara dan begitu. Jadi waktu lalu sudah teman itu ke Makassar, pas kita ke rumahnya itu burungnya sudah sakit, jadi kita ambil aja itu.
Miss Sendi has agreed to surrender ownership voluntarily. The bird will now be housed at the North Sulawesi Agency for Conservation of Natural Resources temporarily before being transported to the Tasikoki Wildlife Center, where it will be rehabilitated and released.
Apakah Bapak pernah melihat di lapangan orang-orang memberi alasan-alasan berbagai macam hanya untuk tidak mau mengaku?
Iya, memang macam-macam alasan. Biasanya itu yang sering terjadi di lapangan.
Kalau seperti itu, apakah mungkin, apakah bisa bahwa itu juga mungkin alasan yang cerita Makassar dan lain-lain?
Iya, bisa saja itu.
In the last 3 years, some 200 birds have been evacuated and received by the agency. Despite the ongoing efforts by authorities to track, trace, and evacuate illegally kept birds, activists have called for stronger law enforcement against illegal traders who continue to operate under the veil of secrecy online. Anyone convicted of illegally catching a protected species faces a jail term of up to 5 years and about $7,000 in fines. The punishment for illegal wildlife trade in Indonesia is relatively low compared to how much traders could profit off sales. Many other people, like Ms. Sendi, face only the prospect of having the bird seized and financial penalties if they are found guilty of running a breeding facility. This is hardly enough to deter illegal wildlife traders in the country. Indonesia has over 1,800 bird species as of 2021, and it is also home to the largest number of threatened bird species in Asia. Despite staunch support from the conservationists and NGOs, the government simply has to put in more resources to protect its rich biodiversity. It's going to be a long road ahead for Indonesia if it wants to effectively stamp out the illegal wildlife trade.